today I am going to show you a lateral approach of the hip, which is also called Hardinge or transgluteal approach. There are various modifications of this approach. I think surgeon should be versatile and he should be conversant with all approaches. I think I have already uploaded a video on posterior approach. This will show you a Hardinge approach, and we will do a hemiarthroplasty of a hip for an intracapsular fracture. So whenever you are dealing with any hip pathology, the x-ray that you should be asking for is pelvis for hips, so that you are able to see most of the femur. That will give us an idea about the canal. Also, it is you have the normal side to compare. So whenever you are doing a hip hemiarthroplasty, it's a good practice to locate the center of the hip and then see where is it in rotation to the greater trochanter. In most patients, the GT will be in line with the center of the hip. On this occasion, the center of the hip is inferior to the line going above the trochanter. So this patient has got coxa vara. On the contrary, in certain patients you will find the hip center is above. Those patients will have coxa valga. So this will give us a good idea when we are putting the implant about the height of the implant. So just also you look at the size of the femoral head. If it's too large or too small, just make sure that you have got smaller sizes or extra large sizes available. So positioning is extremely important. So you have a back support, you have the front support, and the patient should be absolutely vertical. It should not be tilted frontwards or backwards. And make sure that you have tightened every single thing so that it doesn't become loose later on. And when you are moving the hip, if you are immobilized nicely, then ASIs should be stable, it should not move. So now we have prepped and draped our patient. One thing which I showed in my total hip video as well was that people become very, very stingy in terms of preparation of the part. So have a good exposure from proximal as well as distally so that you're not struggling for space. So this is how I prep it. In terms of landmark for your incision, this is the anterior aspect of the femur. This is the tip of the trochanter. Sorry, this is the anterior aspect of the GT. This is the tip of the GT. This is the posterior aspect of the GT. I've drawn this line across the axis of the femur. You don't want to go more than 3 to 5 centimeters up, because then there's a good chance you will encounter superior gluteal vessels and nerve, and if you damage them, that won't be good, because then it will denervate your gluteus medius. So you don't want to go too proximally. Distally, you go around, you know, 5 to 7 or 10 centimeters. I've deliberately made it slightly long. I can do this operation with much smaller incision, but just for demonstrating so that you see it clearly, I have made incision slightly bigger. So let's start with our skin incision. So it's a pretty straight incision, that's why it's called a lateral approach. And as a surgeon, you should know all the approaches. You should not just rely on one approach. So I can open the hip and do a hip replacement through lateral, through posterior, as well as anterior if necessary. So this is our skin, subcutaneous tissue and fat layer done. So let's have some self-retaining retractor. So once we put self-retaining retractor, catch some bleeders, we will expose the first structure, that is the tensor fascia lata. So now we have taken skin down, subcutaneous tissue, fat. Then I use a swab just to move this fat away from the fascia lata. And this swab is a good dissecting tool. And that is what I will do, both front as well as back. And then I will reposition my retractors. Now one common mistake, or one common, it's not a mistake, but one common thing which people do is they don't make full use of their incision. So I have made incision here, so just make full of your incision, both proximally as well as distally, so that you're not struggling for space. So now the white structure that you see is tensor fascia lata. So now you can see, we can clearly see the fascial artery. This bump is your greater trochanter. So I put my finger in the front and the back, and your incision on tensor fascial artery is again pretty much in line with the your skin incision, that is right straight. Don't go too deep. And then we will use a dissecting scissor just to dissect in line and split the fibers. And you can use your finger to separate them. And this big structure that you are seeing is the gluteus medius. This is the powerhouse of the hip. This is the strongest muscle across the hip joint. So you have started seeing this gluteus medius. So I have repositioned the top retractor, and we can see gluteus medius beautifully. We can see this white, that is vastus lateralis. So you always have some bursa on top of it. So I just dissect the bursa so that it falls away. So this is the thick bursa, and this is the bursa which becomes thick and can give you pain when you have trochanteric bursitis. So that's bursa gone out of the way. Same way distally. So then I will ask my assistant to lift the leg up, and then I will reposition this retractor under the fascia lata. Put it down, please. So now we are ready for our next step. So now the next step will be to take the gluteus medius off. So you can see gluteus medius starts here and it comes here. So you don't need to take hold of the gluteus medius. You can leave part of the gluteus medius intact. So I just divide them into probably 2/3 and 1/3. So somewhere across here, in line of the gluteus medius, I just open the muscle fiber. And then I use a swab. Just let's have a small swab. Forceps, please. Then I just put a swab through this to dissect the plane between gluteus medius and the minimus, which is underneath it. So I'll show you once we take this off. So just use one or two swabs to slowly dissect it. But do remember to take it out. So next step will be to take the abductors away. So before that, you just need to pass something underneath the gluteus medius. So now I have passed an artery underneath the gluteus medius that I want to take off. Now this artery is just between gluteus medius and the minimus and capsule underneath it. So start with where you want to take it. So start here. Start here. And then identify the musculotendinous junction, because that is where you want to take this muscle away. So start, come here. And then start taking it at the musculotendinous junction so that you are able to put it back. So this has to come as one single layer. You can take bit of the vastus lateralis as well. So this is our line in which we are going to dissect off the gluteus medius and later on repair it. So as I said, you just need to be very, very close to the bone. So you want to take it as a one cuff. Don't leave any amount of soft tissue back. Just be very, very patient. Now as I am doing it, my assistant will slowly externally rotate the leg. Just wait, not just little bit at the moment. And same here inferiorly. So keep taking it, keep taking it, keep taking it, keep taking it as one single layer. Stay close to it and then keep taking it as one layer. This is the key, that you want to take it as one layer and ask your assistant to externally rotate the leg. Inferiorly, you always have an anastomosis to use coag to dissect, otherwise it always bleeds. So now you can see I have lifted off the gluteus medius, and inside you will start seeing gluteus minimus in a second, I'll show you. So now we have lifted this gluteus medius away just to show you what is the anatomy. So if you can hold it, and then use a swab just to dissect. And then you will start seeing the structure that you see is the minimus. This is the minimus. And then once, so we are just going to reposition our self-retaining retractor, and we are going to put it underneath the gluteus medius. You can take that away, and then I will just clear it up, and once I have cleared it up, I'll show you how it looks. So now, just to reorient yourself, this is the fibers of the gluteus which are away. This gluteus maximus, this is gluteus medius which has been taken away by this retractor. Now the fibers that you see, this is the minimus, and underneath will be capsule. So this is your femoral, this is GT. So your neck will be in this direction. So what we will do is, we will make a cut in this direction and a T-shaped cut. So it will be like this and a T. So here and here we'll make it, and then we will open up the hip joint. So I use a diathermy to make it. So just once go as deep as possible, and then you will see the fracture hematoma coming out. So this is hematoma coming out. Let's have a suction. Once I have sucked, I'll show you how it looks. So far I have just made my vertical cut in line with the neck, and I use my cautery and go as deep as possible. And then the next step will be to just make it like a T here and here. So as you see here, if I open it up, just put some sulfur here please, you can start seeing the hip joint, but I'll show you more clearly. Now the next step will be just to put stay stitches in the end so that we can tie it at a later stage. Let's have a vehicle number one please. So now we have got these two stitch. So what I do is, I lift this up and then make my T, lifting it up so that I am able to expose everything. So this will be my inferior flap. So just keep staying close to the bone. So this is my inferior flap. Same way, lifting it up, I'm just going to make a cut, and this will become my superior flap. So this is my superior, this is my inferior layer, this is my superior layer. I'm just going to put a homen inside here, and one homen superiorly. And then you should be able to see almost everything that you need to see. So you can see that we're just starting to see the head. But I'll just make it a bit more clear, and then I'll get back to you. So now, after putting these two retractors, now you slowly bring the knee and put the leg in the leg bag, and this way you will be able to see that the GT is coming out. So this way, now you can see the neck and the head there. So next thing will be just to identify inferior aspect of the neck and just release the soft tissue so that we are ready for our neck cut. So just going to release from the neck so that, so reposition it again so that you are very close to the neck, and now we can see everything that we need to see. So now we can see the head, it's almost out. We just need to make our neck cut. This will give us more access, and we will be able to remove the head easily. In terms of a neck cut, your neck cut should be 1 cm above the lesser trochanter for most systems. So this is just about right. When you're making the neck cut, this has to be perpendicular to the floor. So that's our neck cut done. So now our neck cut is made. I've just washed it. You can just about see the femoral head. This is an old fracture, and that is the reason this margin is sclerosed. Now next step will be to extract our head. So we need a corkscrew. So always hold the head down and fix it with your head so that you're not placing your corkscrew eccentrically. And sometimes if it's sclerotic, you may have to give a bit of a tap. But the key is, every time you put a thread in, you just rotate the femoral head, because this way, if you have passed the head and if you're now starting to go to the acetabulum, then this movement will disappear. So every time I pass, I just make sure I move it to make sure that I have not gone through the head. So same here. And this also helps in breaking some soft tissue adhesions. So every time you pass, just move that you are not going through the acetabulum, because it's not uncommon that you don't appreciate and then you have gone through the acetabulum. So every thread I just make sure and I just rotate to make sure that it's not gone through the acetabulum. So once your head is free, that means it's now rotating nicely, it means that it has broken away all the adhesions and it's much easier to take it out. Now you need to take it out in line of your capsulotomy. So our capsulotomy in this direction, this is where we are going to take the head out. I think it needs to go a little bit more. Just make sure that you are not coming out of the head. So just lever it out and it should come out. So this is your head out. So next step will be to measure the size of the head. So now you get different kind of sizes depending upon what system do we use. Here we get something like this. So if you see here, it says 45. In 45, this head is going in and out very nicely. So this will be big if you go 45. Here, it is just about going. So I think 43 will be good. If you are in between sizes, then always go for a smaller size. You don't want to go for the bigger size. So 43 looks just about right, that is just passing. And if you look 41, so if you think 41, it's too small. So do measure one size up and one size down, what you think. And on this occasion, we feel 43 is the right size. So we'll use 43 head. So now we are ready for the neck cut. I'm just going to put a swab inside so that no debris goes inside the acetabulum, because one of the commonest cause of hip hemiarthroplasty dislocation is cement or some foreign body in the acetabulum. So we are ready for our box chisel. So the leg has again to be 90 degrees, so start with a, stay in the line with the femur and just stay neutral. I just try to lateralize as much as possible. So that's done. Now again, your femur is this direction. So just remember the direction of the femur and your reamer will go in the same direction. And always try to lateralize. Now the next level will be the rasp. So I use the rasp to lateralize it. So just use it in the hand. This is coming in the way. Let's take this out. Just protect the skin. Smell it. So that's gone in. So let's take the next size. Again, keep pushing laterally. That's also nicely gone in. And we are doing a cemented hemiarthroplasty today, because most joint registries across the world have shown cemented to be faring much better than uncemented. So unless somebody is dying in the next 6 months or somebody is really, really sick, I would do an Austin Moore, else I will always do a cemented hemiarthroplasty. Now, if you are a beginner or if you are in early part of your career, I would recommend that you do a trial so that your leg length is good and you are not facing any challenges in reducing the hip. However, I don't do any trials anymore. All I do is, this is the tip of the trochanter. So this is the tip of the trochanter. I'm just going to make it 90 degree to the head and the hip center. Center of the head is either at the same level, I think it's slightly inferior, which I saw it on the x-ray. So for me, that is good enough. The other hint that you will be able to safely reduce it and you have not lengthened the hip is that if your femoral head is towards the edge of the socket, I'll show you in a second. So now, if your femoral head is towards the end of the socket, I just need a gentle push and it will go. So if you are, your femoral head is towards the edge of the socket, your length is pretty good. If you have an option between making shorter or longer, always go for slightly shorter than longer. I was telling you before that try to always use cemented hemiarthroplasty hip. It has shown better result. However, when you are cementing, especially in an old elderly patient, don't follow that typical step of giving a good lavage and then pressurization. I exclude that step of pressurization, and actually the reason is I had one or two episodes because I used to believe that you always have to have a class A cementing. But if you pressurize too hard, these old patients have got very poor cardiopulmonary reserve. If you pressurize too hard, it sends more embolus, and I had one or two episodes where patient actually collapsed and we had to revive the patient. And that's actually not good. So I have started doing finger cementing. And the second tip is don't put the cement at an early stage when it is too liquid. So wait for it to become slightly solid or slightly semi-solid and then only start cementing. Don't go early in an elderly patient. The cementing technique is pretty same, so I'm not going to show you that. Once I have cemented, I will show you how it looks. And one useful tip is that when you cement, leave few swabs in the acetabulum so that just in case there is some leakage of the cement, it doesn't go into the acetabulum. So I've just put the cement. I'm just doing gentle finger pressurization. Of course, do let your anesthetist know that you're about to cement. And then lateralize as much as possible. Keep one finger there. Just let it go. But it should go in one smooth action. And your knee, of course, has to be 90 degrees. While, as you would do while making the neck cut. So just give me a tap. So while cement is setting, it's extremely important that your assistant keeps the leg maintained and it's not moving, and you also keep a pressure, because cement as it settles expands, and if you don't put a pressure, the implant can actually come out few millimeters. You don't want that, so just keep a gentle pressure while cement is setting down. So cement is finally set, so now we are ready for reduction. So do remember to take the swab out, one and to both of them out, and always do a finger swipe. Always before reduction, make sure that there is nothing inside. You check it, ask your assistant to check it as well. Okay, just put a finger, see if there is anything inside. The most common cause of dislocation is some bony fragment or some part of cement in the acetabulum. Otherwise, hemi rarely dislocates. Now we're ready for reduction. So when you're reducing, no twisting movement. Your assistant will just pull the leg and you will guide the head towards the acetabulum. Now this front and the these two stay suture will keep your soft tissue out. So just gentle traction and gentle push. And if I hear that sound, that says that the hip is now nicely reduced. So once you are about to reduce, just leave 5 or 10 ml of saline in the acetabulum, and as the head, if it's of the right size, you will hear a nice reduction sound. And you can see, and also make sure that there is no soft tissue interposition at any point, because that is another cause of dislocation of the hip. Now once we have reduced it, I am happy, and just do check for the stability. It looks pretty good. Hemiarthroplasty doesn't dislocate unless you have done something nasty during the surgery. So next thing will be just tying these two sutures together, the stay sutures. What they will do is they will bring the minimus and the capsule together. So that is why I leave the, and I'll show you how it looks. So the first stitch is tying these two stay sutures. Let's have a cut, please. So this is our stay stitch. Now I'm just going to use a vicryl to close the minimus and capsule together. So as I say in most of my videos, the most important part of any operation is good dissection and a meticulous closure. So do spend time, don't be in a rush while closing. So I'm just going to put a continuous layer so as to close the minimus and the capsule together. So I'm just going to go through bit deeper. And then I'm just going to run it back. So I'm just putting everything back. So if you see here, this is my most corner stitch. So once I have tied this, it looks, just cut that piece, slightly long, and this one as well. So I've now put a continuous layer across the two ends of the gluteus minimus along with the capsule, and I'm just going to tie it, and you look, it's reconstructed. We have reconstructed it as it was before the operation. So whatever you have cut, try to reconstruct everything back to its original self, and that way you will have an excellent result. So this is my last stitch, and I will show you how I close my gluteus medius. So this is our last stitch here. Our gluteus medius is behind the retractor. I'm just going to release the retractor, and then I'll show you how I close it. So our next layer of closure will be attachment of gluteus medius back to its original self. So this gives a good idea about the leg length and offset. If you're too long, then it won't reach here. And if you're too short, it becomes too lax. Here, it's just about right. Sounds perfect. So I will show you how I close it. So first stitch for gluteus is this corner stitch, which is the most important, because you don't want to create overriding of the, which you should reattach where it should, where you cut it from. So this is my first stitch, cut this, and the second stitch will be where we took it off from the vastus. So this is my second stitch, and if necessary you can ask your assistant to slightly internally rotate the leg, if just to take the pressure off. So this is my second stitch. Cut this slightly long, and then I will run a continuous layer just to close the abductors. You don't want your abductors to fail, because if it fails, then the functional outcome is extremely poor. So I'm just going to run a continuous layer, and I'll show you how it looks once I've done it. So now I've closed my abductors. I just run few times up and down so that the abductor heals nicely. I'll put one stay stitch here, one stay stitch here, just to close this layer of gluteus where we dissected. And then we will start closing the fascia. So I'm just going to put two stay stitch here, just to approximate this gap. So this is my first stitch. So I've just put one stitch on the top. I'm just going to put another stitch on the bottom, just to approximate this gap where we originally opened our gluteus medius. I'm just going to give it a good wash, and then we'll close the fascia. Just take this away. Now this is after our closure, and we have reconstructed it as it was before the operation. So I'll just close the fascia, and then a layer closure until the skin. So the corner stitch of the fascia is extremely important. You should not leave any rent, because if there is any hole in the fascia, then any bleed that is will happen postoperatively will come out, and that will increase the risk of infection. So make sure that your facial layer is watertight. When I say watertight, that means not even a drop of blood should come out of it. Once you reach fascia at a junction where you start to see origin of the muscle, I just put a stay stitch there, so that just in case, because I put a continuous layer, I don't want it to open it out, because the fascia is not as strong superiorly. So this is my stay stitch. Now because there is muscle here, I'm just going to take epimysial layer and then just close it on the top. This is our fascia closed. It will be routine closure afterwards. Some interrupted layer is the fat and followed by routine closure of the skin. So this is our skin closed. We're just going to put a dressing and then that's the end of the operation. Thank you. So viewers, this was a demonstration of hemiarthroplasty of the hip using a Hardinge approach. I hope if you are a surgeon, this video will help you in doing this procedure in a better way. If you are a patient, it will give you some idea about what happens to you during the surgery. Thank you for watching this video. Do share the video and do subscribe to our channel.